did not exist during the Bayesheni. And Mimela, even during the Bayesheni, we are Misabel over the Chorban of the Bayes Rishon. This is very clear from all of the kinos, many, many kinos, as we looked at this morning, talk specifically about the Chorban Bayes Rishon. And you might say, why do I think about that? Because the answer is, I lost something that I never got back. Why is it important to know whether we're mourning over the Bayes Sheni or the Bayes Rishon? Because the Talmud Yerushalmi tells us, Kol dor shelo nivne biyamav kilu nechra biyamav. Any generation in which the Beis HaMikdash is not rebuilt is as guilty as the very generation of the Chorban. The Chorban Beis HaMikdash was not simply something that happened because of those Averos, and we don't have enough of a Zechus to get it back. Rather, the Yerushalmi is telling us, if we would not be guilty of the very same Averos that were Geirim, the Chorban, Bayis, we would have the Binyan Beis HaMikdash. So if it's Yadua that Chazal tell us that the first Beis HaMikdash was destroyed because of the worst Averos of Avodah Zarah, Gili Arayah, Shevichas Domin, and the second Beis HaMikdash was Nechra because of Sinas Chinam, the Yerushalmi is telling me it is not only that we still have the Avera of Sinas Chinam, which is the Chara, very, very Pashat Miyait, but since we are Misabel over the first Beis HaMikdash as well, we must still have the Averas of Avodah Zarah, Gili Arayah, Shevichas Domin. That L'chaira raises a question. I understand that we still live in a world that is plagued with polarization, with hatred, with animosity, with coldness, with indifference. One doesn't even have to be marich on this, although one should be marich, because we need to hear it and internalize it over and over again. How the pirud and the dissension and the machlokes and the coldness and the indifference is so powerful and overwhelming that it keeps us in a gullus for almost 2,000 years. So on one hand, we need to hear the message, we need to internalize the message, we need to understand the message, but on some level, it's a pashut message. We see it, it's obvious. But to say that we still have Avodah Zarah, Gilei Arayah, Shevichas Domin, we're not that bad. Avodah Zarah, we don't bow down to idols. Shevichas Domin, most of us at least haven't murdered anybody. Gilei Arayah. In what sense do we have any shaychus at all to the Averis of the first Chorban? So there are many, many different answers and approaches to this. How we correlate our matzav even to the Averis of the first Chorban and not just the second Chorban. One approach is that Chazal say that spiritually, many Averis that we don't regard as so serious are connected to these serious Averis. Chazal say, for example, kol akayes, if a person is angry, ki ilu shofech damim, that is equal to shvichas damim. Chazal say that malbin pnei chaverei is considered ritzicha, humiliating somebody publicly ritzicha. There's another chazal by Kas that Kas is avodah zarah, as the Baal HaTanya writes, because when you're angry and you're frustrated, you're not accepting the fact that God is in charge of the world. Gilei Arayos, Chazal say, Hirhurei Avera, thoughts, stimuli, media that incite sexual temptation are as bad as the Avera itself. So even if literally I don't stick a knife in a person's heart, have I been malbin pnei chaverei barabin? Even if literally I don't bow down to an idol, do I have anger in not accepting the hashgacha of Hashem? Or do I elevate money or professionalism or success or kavod to be the new idol that I worship? Self-idolization. Hirhurei Avera, kashin me Avera. So in a very literal way, if we understand Chazal's correlation, we are indeed mashuka in Avodah Zarah, Gilei Arayah, Shevichas Domin, even if not in the most literal way possible. That is one simple answer. Second answer You know, the Beis Yosef, Rav Yosef Karo, the author of the Shulchan Aruch, besides being Gadol Hador, the Pesach Hador, and by the way, he was a four-year-old child on the Tisha B'Av that the Jews left Spain, were expelled from Spain. The Abarbanel, who was the Zakein of the door, was at the head of the procession. And the young child who'd become Rav Yosef Karo, the Mechaber, was towards the end of the procession with his mother. But Rav Yosef Karo was also a very great Mekubal. It's brought down that he used to go to hear the Arizal. The Arizal was much, much younger. But every time he went to the Arizal, he fell asleep. And the Arizal said, it was Nigzer in Shemayim that it's not your kavod that you should learn from me. But the Beis Yosef himself was a great Mekubal. And he had a malach that he would learn from, called a magid, a private chavrusa. And he even gave us a diary of his encounters with this angel, Magid Meisharim. You can actually read his discussions with the malach. And in the Magid Meisharim, he tells a story that one time he was miyageya over a difficult sugya in Maseches Ksuvas, and he worked very, very hard till he finally had a pshat in it. And he's walking in the side streets of Tzfat. We've been there, you know what it's like. He happens to overhear a shoemaker who is learning that very same sugya with his seven-year-old son. Well, you don't want to eavesdrop, but, you know, obviously it interested Rav Yosef Karo what they would say about the sugya. And the shoemaker's son, the seven-year-old, asked his father the very kasha that had been bothering Rav Yosef Karo. So Rav Yosef Karo now is very, very interested. And the father is annoyed, and the father says to his son, I knew this was too difficult for you. You're asking such simple questions that are obvious. The pshat is such and such. Exactly what it took the Beis Yosef, the Gadol Hador, 2 weeks to figure out. So Rav Yosef Karo was totally demoralized, because apparently if this was so pashut that the father has a taina on a seven-year-old for not getting the pshat, what avera did he have that he couldn't see it? So Baruch Hashem, he has someone to ask. He asked the malach, what is my avera? What is my chatasi, my pishi? What is my chisarin? Why was there not zeicha to understand an obvious truth in the Torah that's so pashut that kids are supposed to understand it? And the malach told him, it was exactly the opposite. The chiddush that you had was something that was very deep and very wondrous, and the world was not deserving of it. And it was an aspect of connection to Hashem that this earth was not yet roy for. But through your yegiya, through your amelus, through your mesiras nefesh, you brought it down into this physical earth. And once it was brought down into this physical environment, anybody could get it, even a child. This is what is recorded. This is the phenomenon where often a person who's learning could be mechaven, right? You could be mechaven, that's kind of the highest compliment. You're mechaven to a taisvis, or later a ketzais achayshen, or a Rav Chaim. That doesn't mean, I don't want to burst anybody's bubble, that doesn't mean we learn as well as taisvis, the ketzais achayshen, or Rav Chaim. But they brought these chidushim into the world. They then become accessible. On a rational level, this makes no sense at all. Rav Yosef Karo didn't write what he learned. He didn't teach it. He didn't communicate it. What do you mean you brought it into the world? You didn't tell anybody. It remained in your mind, in your heart. But the answer is, that is the nature of Ruchnius. That is the nature of Kedusha. That when we sit by ourselves, nobody knows what we're doing. You're sitting in the Beis Medrash. You're steiging, you're learning, you're davening, you're serving Hashem. And people say on the outside world sometimes, what are you accomplishing? What are you doing for the world? You're not a teacher, you're not a rabbi. You're not even doing that. But a yid has to know that every time we do mitzvahs, we serve Hashem, we learn Torah, we're bringing Kedusha into the world that changes the world, that elevates the world, that makes it a different type of existence. The Chafetz Chaim used to say that the learning of the Bachurim in Radin had some type of effect on the Tznius in Paris. that if in Radin they were learning 14 hours like an atom bomb, you have ground zero and then progressively weaker radiation, but it goes very, very far. That maybe in Paris they're not going to learn 12 hours, but the tznius will be a little better than it would be. This is the kayach of Torah, the kayach of ruchnius. It's a reality that changes the world. But what does that mean? That means if you look at a world, and a world is decadent, and a world is corrupt, and a world is meshuka and tuma, that even if we're not guilty of any of that, it must be that the kedusha that we could have created was not as great to dispel that. So if we go back to the question, how are we guilty of avodah zarah, gilui arayos, shvichas damim? The answer is, even if we're not guilty of avodah zarah, gilui arayos, shvichas damim, if we live in a world, living in a world that's meshuke and shvichas damim, pashut, living in a world of avodah zarah, so it depends, Baruch Hashem, there aren't that many openly idolatrous cultures, although there are. But as the Vilna Gaon said, when the Anshei Knesset HaGdolah took away the Yetzer Hara of idolatry, it was replaced by the Yetzer Hara for money and materialism. And that too is a form of Avodah Zarah. And Mimela, if we live in a world of Avodah Zarah, Gilui Shvichas Damim, it is a simon to us that the Kedusha that we could have generated was not generated to the same degree that it could have been. Because if Kedusha can dispel the Tuma, then when there is Tuma, by definition, the Kedusha was not strong enough. And in that sense, we still have a Shaychus to Avodah Zarah, Gilui Arayos, Shvichas Damim. The world can be changed by the isolated activity of the person that is Yeshev Eisek Batayra. The Gemara in Sanhedrin says, the definition of an apikairis, apikairis has many definitions. Kaifer, biyud gimelik reyamuna, there are many ways you can be an apikairis. But one of those ways is a quite surprising way. A yid could keep mitzvahs. A yid could put on tefillin every day. A yid could keep kashrus and Shabbos. But if his attitude is, my ahani lan rabbanan, what do the rabbis do for us? Meaning, in a more general sense, what is people who are sitting and learning Torah, what are they accomplishing for the world? The Gemara says that is apikorsis, because one is denying the kayach of Torah to change existence. And that is how we have a shaychus to avodah zarah, gilui arayos, shvichas damim. Rav Tzadok takes it in a slightly different way. And Rav Tzadok says, avodah zarah, this is the third answer, avodah zarah, gilui arayos, shvichas damim, are great averis to be sure, but they are symptoms of deeper spiritual flaws. And even if we don't exhibit the symptomology, we still have the underlying root causes. And he connects it to the three destroyers of spiritual life. And Pirkei Avos says, that's kina, taiva, kavod. Jealousy, excessive lust for the material and the sensual, and kavod, the need for honor, self-aggrandizement, ego gratification. They are machrib, they're maitziyan es ha'adam in ha'ilam. They take a person out of this world, they destroy his ilam haba for sure, and they destroy his ability to accomplish anything significant in this world. And Rav Tzadok says very simply that the extreme expression of jealousy is shvichas damim. One is so jealous, one is enraged that one kills. The extreme expression of taiva is gilui arayos. And then finally he says that the idea of kavod is avodah zarah. Because when man makes himself the measure of what is the supreme value, my kavod, my ego, my honor, instead of recognizing that all honor belongs to Hashem, that is a form of avodah zarah, that is self-worship. So Rav Tzadok says, when we connect ourselves to the avera of Avodah Zarah, Gilui Arayos, Shfichas Damim, we are not automatically referring to the specific Aveira, but the character flaws of Kina, Taiva, V'Kavod. And each person, each of us, on this day must make our own Cheshbon HaNefesh, because remember that the Chiyuv of being Misabel over the Churban is not simply the Chiyuv of crying over the past, but it's resolving in whatever way we can to be Baina the Beis HaMikdash. As I mentioned earlier, our chiyuv to be Baina the Mikdash does not mean to physically build a Mikdash. Rashi says the third Mikdash is Yored Min HaShamayim. The Rambam says the third Mikdash is going to be built by Mashiach. There is a Yerushalmi Taka that says we should build the Beis HaMikdash, and that brings Mashiach, and that is the smach of the Temple Mount groups. But all I can say is lahalacha, we don't follow that. And the Gedolim have actually said, by and large, not to follow that view. So our job is not to physically build a Mikdash. But what we do is we make a Mikdash for the Eibishter in our heart and our soul. V'yasuli Mikdash v'shachanti b'seicham, when Hashem dwells within us. And therefore, Rav Tzadok says, the same way, when you make a building, the first thing you have to do is get rid of the junk on the building site. Get rid of the garbage and the junk. The first step to building a mikdash, a dwelling place for the Eibishter, in our heart and in our soul, is to work on the midos of kina, taiva, v'kavod, to try to uproot it, to try to improve it, to try to get rid of all of those things that are maineya. And every time we do that, as well as working on Sinas Chinam and Avas Yisrael, which is the Bayis Sheni, what we're doing is we are adding a brick in the celestial Beis HaMikdash in Shemayim. And when enough of those bricks are added in the heavenly Beis HaMikdash, we are then Zaycha to the Bayis HaShlishi, coming down min HaShemayim. The Beis HaMikdash is symbolic of the Metzius of HaKadosh Baruch Hu being with us. When Nebuchadnezzar destroyed the Bayis Rishon, he was very proud of what he did. He boasted. He says, I have defeated God. I have driven God from his house. And the Almighty responded, you did not drive me from my house. I did not live there anymore. When Am Yisrael was no longer Zoche to be a repository of the Shechina, I left the Mikdash. When you destroyed the Mikdash, you destroyed a house, you destroyed a building. Fancy buildings can be destroyed. The one who really destroyed the Mikdash was us. We destroyed the Mikdash. And we rebuild the Mikdash by bringing HaKadosh Baruch Hu back into our heart, back into our soul. And precisely this awareness of loss is going to be the impetus towards binyan. Everyone knows the famous Gemara, that the Gemara in Sanhedrin, Mashiach is born on the 9th of Av. And the Maharal explains that it does not necessarily refer to the actual birthday of Mashiach. Mashiach, the person, his birthday could be any day of the year. But rather it means that the spiritual power that will bring Mashiach into the world, the spiritual koach that brings Geula, is the depth of the yearning and the sense of need that we have. And therefore, the magnitude of our Avelus and Tisha B'Av brings the koach of Geula in the world. Rashiv often mentions Rav Huttner's wonderful statements, that the one thing Rav Huttner said he missed about Chutz La'aretz when he came to Eretz Yisrael was he missed the yearning to be in Eretz Yisrael, because he was in Eretz Yisrael. And that's a humorous remark, but it's a remark that has a profound truth. Sometimes, as the expression in English goes, absence makes the heart grow fonder. That on most Yomim Tovim, we celebrate the closeness we have with the Ribbono Shel Olam. But there are times in which we have to focus on the distance we have from the Ribono Shel Olam, how far we are. But paradoxically, in experiencing the distance, in feeling how far we are, that creates a yearning, and that yearning creates a closeness. And it's on both sides, because just as we are mishtaikek to be connected with HaKadosh Baruch Hu, it's even more so that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is mishtaikek to be connected with us. And therefore, there is a paradox that in the awareness of distance, there is enormous closeness and burning love. And the Maharal says, that is the koach that brings Mashiach into the world. If you want it, he will come. It will come. It all depends on the ratzon that we have, and the ratzon comes from the sense of how much we need HaKadosh Baruch Hu, how much we need Geula, what our lives are like without a Mikdash. But as I said, going back to what I said earlier, our Avodah starts off with cleaning out the garbage, cleaning up the building site, to be Mesakein, the kina taiva v'kavod. In this sense, I want to switch gears a little bit, but it will ultimately be connected with the idea that it turns out that in the seeds of Chorban itself, or in the phenomenon of Chorban, are the seeds out of which redemption comes. One way this is so is by the process of yearning that creates love. But we see this throughout. It is a recurring pattern. Just as a plant or a grain cannot grow until the seed disintegrates, it is the nature of all new creation that there be kind of a disintegration and disappearing of the old. And that is why in the very framework of creation it was built in a pattern of golos. We find over and over again that within the Chorban there are the seeds and intimations of redemption. Let me give you quickly just three examples of this. Part of it I mentioned in the keynotes this morning. When Yaakov Avinu is running away from Esav, and Yaakov Avinu is very, very frightened. He is impoverished. He's leaving his father and mother. He's leaving Eretz Yisrael. He's going to the spiritually corrosive environment of Lavan. His life is threatened. Talk about between a frying pan and a fire. Esav wants to kill him bodily. Lavan, he fears, will destroy him spiritually. And in the middle of the day, the sun sets and it becomes totally dark. Shaka hachama shalai b'aynasa. And Yaakov is hopeless and helpless and feels that there is no way he will ever be out of his sorrow. And Hashem comes to him in the glorious dream of reassurance. Now, what's interesting is that on one level, Yaakov Avinu could see this as a totally bad sign. In the middle of the day, the sun sets. Isn't God giving me a message? My life is total darkness and defeat. There is no light that is left. What a message, what a downer, what a negative nevuah is HaKadosh Baruch Hu giving him at that moment. This is before he had the dream. And yet, Chazal say, the Shaka Chama Shalai B'Aynasa was actually a message of comfort, although it's not clear if Yaakov understood it as such at the time. We read in this morning's Parsha, Ki Solid Banim Uvnei Banim, when you have children and grandchildren, V'noshantim B'yaretz, and they will have dwelt in the land a very long time, and they will turn to idols, HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, Ha'idaisi B'chem Hayayim, I am testifying, Ki Avai Taived in Maher, you will be utterly destroyed. Rashi brings a medrash that says the gematria of a Nishantim is 852 years. Had the Jewish people been in Eretz Yisrael 852 years and worshipped idols, the Pasuk would have said they would have been wiped out right away. As it were, HaKadosh Baruch Hu exiled us 2 years before that point. We were actually in Eretz Yisrael 850 years. We know this because it was 440 years from the time we entered the land until the Binyan Beis HaMikdash, and the first Mikdash was Omeid, 410 years, 450 and 410. I'm sorry, 440 and 410 is 850. And the Midrash says Hashem exiled us 2 years earlier than he should have, in order that the part of the pasuk that says we will be utterly destroyed would not be fulfilled. And Chazal say the Midrash that Hashem caused the sun to set earlier than it should have was a remez that the gullus of darkness will be 2 years early. So, superficially, you think it's bad. You think God is cruel. You think that Hashem is punishing us even more than we deserve because we should have had 852 years as Vinoshantim, and instead he did it early. But it all turns out that that earlier gullus was L'Toivaseinu, because that prevented the necessity of Abei Tabdun Maher. In the gullus itself is Tamun, the koach of redemption, the koach of Geula. In this connection, let me say there's another thing that happened when the sun set prematurely. And that is, and this is before Yaakov's dream. He didn't have the dream till afterwards. Yaakov Avinu was mesakein tefilas arvis. Avraham did shachris, Yitzchak did mincha, Yaakov did arvis. Vayivka b'makayim v'yolin sham kivah ha-shemesh. The sun set. Yaakov said, I will be mesakein marif. Rav Tzadok asks a very good kasha. We know that there's a machlekes in the Gemara, but lahalacha we paskin that the davening of the Shemone Esrei of Ma'ariv is a rishus. It is optional. It is not a chiyuv. So frek Rav Tzadok, if Avram's prayer is an obligation and Yitzchak's prayer is an obligation, Yaakov Avinu, the choicest, the greatest of the Avos, the only one of the Avos that was Zocha, that all of his children are part of Klal Yisrael. Why should Yaakov Avinu's prayer be inferior to that of the prayer of Avram and Yitzchak? How can you say Yaakov did Ma'ariv and Tfilas Arvis is Rishus? So Rav Tzadok says, very beautiful and moving thought that we can actually internalize in all of our tefillos every day. Every tefillah, even though it's the same word, same Shemone Esrei, is designed to elicit a different mood in how we connect to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Shachris, which ideally should be Davin Kavasikin as the sun comes up, is a prayer of hope and gratitude. It's a new day, a new opportunity. This is the Midah of Avraham Avinu, who perceived Hashem's kindness in the world, who saw many of the Ribbono Shel Olam's promises fulfilled in Avraham Avinu, who was respected, who was well regarded, who was makarev thousands and thousands of people, tachas kanfei Ashkina, who was zoche to a son when he was 100 years old, and even the so-called bad son, Yishmael, did tshuva in the lifetime of Avraham Avinu. And Lehepech Esav did not become a Rasha till after Avraham Avinu died, at least openly. So Avraham Avinu was well positioned to see the God of kindness, the God of chesed, the God of rachamim. And that's the prayer of Shachris, where every morning there is a new morning that is filled with hope. And therefore Shachris is the prayer of joy, the prayer of hope, the prayer of gratitude. Yitzchak's tefillah is mincha. Now granted, we daven mincha gedola, but mincha is often davened before shkia, hopefully, but with the lengthening shadows of the evening. Mincha is sugapas to Yitzchak, because on one hand, Yitzchak never left Eretz Yisrael. But he began to feel the night coming on. Remember, the 400 years of exile begin with the birth of Yitzchak. He was given the message, even by the local Philistines, the Plishtim, this isn't his land, he doesn't belong there. Mincha is the prayer of panic. A person turns to Hashem and says, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, I still have your brachos, but I feel and I fear they're slipping away. Let me hold on to it. That's the midah of pachad, Yitzchak. The pachad, the fear, the trepidation, the worry, the concern that maybe I won't be zeicha to hold it on. So Shachris is the prayer of gratitude. Mincha is the prayer of panic. In fact, even in terms of time frame, mincha is a panicky prayer. In Eretz Yisrael, Baruch Hashem, less so. But in Chutz La'aretz, you often have to, you're in the middle of the train station, the bus station. You know, mincha has a window that's a small window. And you get, you know, you have to worry about this. Before there were cell phones, all the phone booths in Port Authority in New York always had religious people davening mincha through their phone calls to the Ribbono Shel Olam. What is Ma'ariv? Ma'ariv is not the prayer of gratitude for the light of Hashem that's apparent. And it's not even the panic, I have your brachos, but I'm so afraid. Ma'ariv is when you hit rock bottom. It's dark. This was Yaakov Avinu's life. Remember, he didn't have the dream till after he davened Ma'ariv. At this point, Yaakov Avinu feels bereft of anything that could sustain him. His physical life is in danger. His spiritual life is in danger. He doesn't have a wife. He doesn't have a child. He doesn't have possessions. He doesn't know what the next day is going to be. It's like the situation of a Jew in a concentration camp. So Rav Tzadok says, Shachris, prayer of gratitude. Mincha, prayer of panic. Ma'ariv is the prayer of Emunah. Emunah says that even if I don't see the light, even if I don't see when this tunnel is going to end, I am maimin that everything HaKadosh Baruch Hu does is going to be good, and it's good even right now, not just to believe in the light at the end of the tunnel, but to see within the Chayshech itself, the aura of Hashem. And Rav Tzadok says, going back to the question, the reason Ma'ariv is optional is not because it's less chashuv, but rather it's the other way around. Anything that's a chayva can be expected of every 13-year-old boy. So to be grateful for the good in your life, yeah, a child should know that. To pray to Hashem when you're in trouble, know that too. But to reach the level where even in darkness I perceive the goodness and light of Hashem, that is a high madriga. The optionality, so to speak, of Arvitz does not stem from its being inferior, but it's something to which we aspire that we're not always able to become. Right? This is the idea of the morning of Tisha B'Av, the Avelus of Tisha B'Av, to see in the darkness the seeds of the redemption. Just as in Yaakov Avinu, Shaka Chama Shalai B'Ainasa, was a remez to the 2 years before Vinoshantim, that on one level looked like a midas adin, it looked like an onesh, it looked like a shreklecha, rejection by Hashem. And yet that very rejection was the key to how we even survived. Because had we been in Eretz Yisrael 852 years, there would have been no Hatzalah. In a related matter, we know that 1 week after Tisha B'Av, the seventh day from Tisha B'Av, we have a very festive day, a day that's called the 15th of Av, Tu B'Av. The Mishnah says in Maseches Tainis, Lo hayu yamim tovim li Yisrael. There were no days in Am Yisrael that were as happy and joyous as Yom HaKippurim and Chamisha Asar B'Av. And the Gemara in Tainis asks, we understand why Yom Kippur, V'shteitzach, is such a happy day, which is interesting. Sometimes in the Jewish world, they don't look at it as a happy day, but it's a happy day, a day of forgiveness, a day of reconciliation, a day of Matan Torah, the Lucha Shnias. It's Pashat. Yeah, you're not eating, you're standing up, that's fine. But there's no day as happy as Yom Kippur. But what is so great about the 15th of Av? Why is the 15th of Av such a day of Simcha? So the Gemara in Tainis gives no fewer than six reasons why Chamisha Asar B'Av is a day of Simcha. The first reason it gives is that in the 40th year in the desert, that is when the Meisei Midbar, the people who were supposed to die in the desert because of the Meraglim, they stopped dying. Now, the Gemara doesn't really explain it. Rashi brings a Medrash and a Yerushalmi. And it's a very, very shver medrash. The Yerushalmi basically says this. Every Erev Tisha B'Av, The whole generation of the Midbar, no matter what their age is, if they were from 20 onwards, they would dig graves, and they would sleep in those graves. They would experience death. And everybody who reached the age of 60 did not get up the next morning. So everybody had to go through the experience, but the people who reached age 60 did not, they died, they did not get up. Everyone else got up. And that was repeated year after year after year after year to commemorate that first Tisha B'Av night when they cried, the Bechiya Shel Chinam, not trusting and having emunah in Hashem. The 40th year, the remaining people, most of them were already dead, but the remaining 15,000 on the average, dug their grave. They didn't die. What happened? So they thought, perhaps we made a mistake in the Cheshvan. Maybe it's not the 9th of Av, maybe it's the 8th of Av. So they kept on sleeping in the grave. The next day, the day after, the day after, by the time it got to the 15th of Av, they saw a full moon. So they knew that the 9th of Av must have passed, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu was mevater. Now, it's a very, very shver Yerushalmi, because according to the Yerushalmi, it turns out that 15,000 people who should have died did not die the last year, even though the Torah made it that Yehoshua and Kaleb were the only men who survived. Okay, I'm not going to be miyashiv, but there's a lot of dion in this Yerushalmi. But the Yerushalmi Taka says, again, from the Bavli, you don't know. The Bavli doesn't clearly say it. In fact, Tysus has another pshat. When the Bavli says the people stopped dying, that means they did die the last Tisha B'Av. They sat Shiva, and then on the 15th of Av, you know, they were able to be Misameach, that Hashem spoke to them again. But according to the Yerushalmi, there was no death on that last Tisha B'Av. So that became that Simcha. That's reason number one. Reason number two is that it mentions that in the days of the 10 tribes from Yeravam ben Nevat, he put up guards, he put up golden calves, and he put up guards so that the Jews from the 10 tribes, northern kingdom, would not visit the Beis HaMikdash. But the last of the 10 tribe kings, Hoshea ben Ela, removed the guards and said, whoever wants to go to the Beis HaMikdash, go ahead, go to the Beis HaMikdash. And Chazal had a Messiah that was on the 15th of Av. And that's a big simcha because people could serve Hashem. To serve Hashem, that's a gewaldige thing. The Gemara in Tainus asks the obvious kasha, he did such a good thing, and then they get destroyed? That's when Sancheirav comes and destroys them? Fakert, this should be a zechus. So the Gemara gives us a very important warning. It says, yeah, he said anybody who wants to go can go, but nobody went. Meaning all the years they didn't go. They had an excuse, we can't, the army's not letting us go. When you have the opportunity and you don't use it, then chas v'shalom. On one hand, it's a gewaldige simcha to have an opportunity. But it's an achrayus, it's a responsibility. I have to say, you know, Baruch Hashem, in this day and age, there are so many enhanced opportunities for learning Torah that earlier generations didn't have. Whether it's translations, we hope to get people beyond translations, but whatever it is, you might call it crutches, you might call it things that assist you, things that can help you. Tremendous thing. But you know, when opportunities exist, there are responsibilities to use them. So that's the second reason. The third reason is that it mentions that the B'nai Salafchad, you'll recall, were told when they inherited property, they were not allowed to marry any men from a tribe other than their tribe because there was a fear that property would go from one tribe to another tribe, and that was not proper. They were from the tribe of Menashe. They were commanded they could only marry men from Menashe. They cannot marry men from another tribe, lest the property go to their husbands or their children, and that would be taking land from one tribe to another tribe. It was understood, however, that this was only a temporary halacha until Eretz Yisrael was divided, and that sometime after the Kibush V'Chiluk, it was permitted for all of the Shvatim to intermarry, and that was on the 15th of Av. So it's Yom Shehutru Shvatim, that's why it became a day of Shiduchim. And then there's a second Hutru Shvatim, the Gemara says, which is the fourth reason, And the second instruction was in the Pelegish Begiva, when there was a great war against the tribe of Binyamin, and Binyamin was almost decimated, and people took a solemn oath they would not allow their child, their daughter, to marry a Binyaminite, and a tribe almost became extinct when they finally matired the neder, allowing Shevet Binyamin. That became a simcha, right? So far we have four reasons. The Meisei Amidbar stopped. Hoshea ben Ela, this is before the Chorban Bayis Rishon, took away the guards that prevented people going to the Mikdash. We have the a woman who inherits property could marry a man from another tribe. Shevet Binyamin was readmitted into Klal Yisrael. And the fifth and the sixth reason is Beitar was destroyed in the Bar Kokhba revolt around 60 years after the Chorban, on Tisha B'Av as well. But the Romans did not allow the bodies to be buried for 3 years to break the rebellious spirit of the Jews. Finally, after 3 years, there was a miracle. The bodies did not disintegrate or decompose or putrefy. So the emperor finally said, bury them, and that's why we added that bracha in benching, that Hashem is good, Hatova Ameitev, that the bodies didn't spoil and they were buried. And the Messiah is, we were given permission to bury the Haruge Beitar on the 15th of Av. So that's 3 years and 1 week after the destruction of Beitar, because Beitar was destroyed on the 9th of Av. This is 3 years later on the 15th of Av, we could bury. And the final reason is an ecological reason, and that is the 15th of Av was the last day that we completed wood cutting for the Beis HaMikdash, because after the 15th of Av, the summer gets a little, the days get a little shorter, and as a result, the wood is a little bit moist, it is not as dry as it would be, and it is not as suitable for the Mizbeach. So every time they completed the wood cutting, that was a simcha of the 15th of Av, that Baruch Hashem, we have enough wood for the coming year. Six reasons why the 15th of Av is a Yom Tov. Why is that so important? The reason why it's so important is, let us remember that there are five sorrows on Tisha B'Av. There are five reasons why Tisha B'Av is a day of Chorban and a day of Tsar. And what I want you to see is that each tragedy of Tisha B'Av, the Eibishter gave us a corresponding nechama. After we sat Shiva on the seventh day of Shiva, he gives us a nechama for that tragedy. Tragedy number one of Tisha B'Av was the chait of the Meraglim who spoke Lashon Hara, and as a result, it was nigzar al aviseinu shelo yikansu liaretz. That was the gezeira of Tisha B'Av. But on the 15th of Av, 40 years later, that gezeira was annulled. HaKadosh Baruch Hu took it away. Batlu meisei midbar. The Bayis Rishain was Necharav on Tisha B'Av, because primarily because of the Chet of Avodah Zarah. That was the first of the three. Well, but on the 15th of Av, although this is before the Chorban, but looking at it in a cosmic way, that is when the Eglei Hazav of Yeravam ben Nevat were removed and the Yidden could go and worship Hashem in the Beis HaMikdash. So the Tikkun for the Avodah Zarah that caused the Chorban Bayis Rishain was Mesukin through Hoshea ben Ela, allowing people to worship Hashem. The Bayis Sheni was Nechra because of Sinas Chinam. But on Chamisha Asar B'Av, we see two examples. This is where you got six. Two examples of breaking down barriers. Sinas Chinam are barriers, Pirud, Machlokas. When one Jew cannot connect to another Jew. But on Chamisha Asar B'Av, a woman who inherited property could marry every Jew. Shevet Binyamin was welcomed back. It's the nechama that helps us overcome the sinas chinam by creating achdus. On the 9th of Av, Beitar was destroyed, and on the 15th of Av, 3 years later, the Haruge Beitar were nitnu likvura. And the final tragedy that is recorded is Nechre Shahoyir. Yerushalayim was plowed over with sulfur and salt, destroying its fertility, In fact, the Yerushalmi even has a beautiful lesson. The Yerushalmi says, Kama chatsufa Eretz Yisrael. Eretz Yisrael is so nervy, so arrogant, as it were, that in spite of everything that was done to it, it's still able to produce. It's quite amazing. That itself is l'mayla min hateva. But it only produces for us. It doesn't produce for anybody else. And the Yerushalmi's lesson is, Kama chatsufa Eretz Yisrael. And yet, if the ninth of Av, part of our tragedy is the destruction of the kayach of Eretz Yisrael to be Megadel, on the 15th of Av, we celebrated that the Eibishter gave us the ability to have the Eitzim L'Maracha. So the point basically is that side by side with the Avelus and the Chorban and the tragedy, the Eibishter says, be Misabel. But then you have to get up from Shiva, so to speak. The 15th of Av is getting up from Shiva. And each tsar, the Eibishter gives you a nechama. Everyone knows the famous Gemara in Makkos. The Gemara in Makkos where the Chachamim are walking with Rabbi Akiva by the Har Habayis. And they see a shual, a fox that comes out of the Kodesh HaKadoshim. And the Chachamim cry, and Rabbi Akiva laughs, and the Chachamim say to Rabbi Akiva, why are you laughing? And he says to them, why are you crying? And he said, and they say to him that the Hazorah Karavim is the holiest place in the world where if a non-Kohen goes in, he's Chayav Misa. And now, Shual and Hilchubai. And Rabbi Akiva said, for that I laugh. Because until I saw how the prophecies of destruction were Mekuyam in such a literal way, I wasn't sure that the prophecies of Geula would be fulfilled in such a literal way. But from the Chorban itself, I could be margish that there will be a Geula. And therefore Rabbi Akiva's kayach was to see in the darkness of Chayshech, in the Hester Panim of Galus, in what looks like Hashem rejecting you, he saw in that the hidden light that would bring Geula in the world. In many ways, I say, Chamish Esrei B'Av is bringing out the hidden light of Tisha B'Av and bringing out in an open, revealed way. It's Yadua, the Chassam Sofer is famous for it. Some say it in the name of other people, but Kol HaMisabel Al Yerushalayim Zaycha V'Reya B'Simchasa. All who mourn over Yerushalayim. So we always translate it as will merit and will see its joy. But grammatically, that's not the case. Zoche v'roa is not a future tense. It does not say yiskeh v'yira. Zoche says, he who mourns over Yerushalayim sees it now. In the Chorban, you see the binyan. How is that shaykh? How do I see the binyan in the Chorban? So they say, b'shem the Chassam Sofer, this thought. When the brothers tried to tell Yaakov that Yosef was killed, and they brought him a kesinus that was dipped in blood. So it says, v'yimayin lehisnachem, Yaakov Avinu refused to be comforted. And Rashi brings from Chazal, that although the derech klal, if God forbid, a person suffers a bereavement, with the passage of time, the pain is less intense, and you're able to go on. That's a bracha of the Kaddish Baruch Hu, that we're able to go on, that we don't get destroyed by grief. That's only when the person is dead. When the person's alive, even if you don't know that they're alive, you're not going to be able to be mekabel tanchumin. Ein mekabel tanchumin alachai, because HaKadosh Baruch Hu's gezeira of shichicha is only on a mace, not on a chai. Right? That's what Rashi says. That's why Yaakov Avinu could not be mekabel nechama. Now, why didn't Yaakov realize that Yosef was alive because of that? That's another kasha. But Yaakov was not mekabel nechama. So says the Chassam Sofer like this. The Chorban happened so many years ago. And of course, we could add another 250 years to the Chassam Sofer. Why don't we get over it? Why do we still have a tishra? Why do we sit on the ground? Why are we saying kinos and echa? If Geula is dead, then we would get over it. We would be makabel tanchumin. But if we're not makabel tanchumin, that must mean it's still alive. Therefore, kol ha-mis'abel al Yerushalayim, you're still margish, churban. In the very fact that you're margish, the churban, zaychev reib z'mechasa, you see in that alone the geula. And that's why ein makablin tanchumen alachai. B'ezras Hashem, this should be the very last Tisha B'Av, 10th of Av, that would be a tainus, as the Navi Zechariah says. These days will become days of sasein v'simcha, but as I said earlier, the geula will come commensurate and in proportion to how much we yearn for it, how much we feel we need it, and how much effort we put in to making our heart and our soul a place of the Shechina. May HaKadosh Baruch Hu help us to live our lives that way, and in that way, we and all of Kol Yisrael and the whole world should be zeicha to a geula shleima b'mehirah v'yameinu.